Hello and welcome to the Legislative Journal for September 2022 with State Representative Greg Vitali from the 166th Legislative District representing Delaware and Montgomery counties. Well, summer recess has ended. Did you learn anything interesting or do anything exciting this summer?
Well, thanks, Dan. Thanks for hosting. Frankly, session is very busy and we came off a fairly aggressive campaign. So what I usually use these, let's say 8 weeks or so, is to, in many ways, just catch up with some personal things, work around the house and things like that. But also trying to anticipate what we're going to be doing in the fall and getting ready and doing background information. One thing we've been doing, we developed some legislation relating to PFAS, which is a toxic chemical, a forever chemical that gets into water supplies. For example, up in the Willow Grove area, they have a problem. It's used in firefighting foam. And so we spent a little time developing that piece of legislation, mainly an amendment to a bill, Senate Bill 302 by Senator Yaw, which if it is introduced or moved in the next six session days between now and the end of the term, we'll be ready to throw it on. So we worked on that a bit. The hydrogen hub is a big issue coming up, just trying to get our head around that, background information on that. Mainly just got our newsletter out, mainly just trying to get to those things that you can't do in the legislative swirl. Things just happen really fast once you get back into sessions. But we do have we just finished our first session week of the fall season. And so we only really have six session days left. We're frankly right now out again until late October. We have a couple of session days in October, a couple after the November 8th election, and that's it. Then the two-year term is over and we adjourn sine die, as they say. And what that means is that any bill that has not passed both the House and the Senate in identical form and is heading to the governor's desk, any bill that is not in that position is dead, and it goes back to square one, if at all, when the next term starts, which is after we all get sworn in January. So it was a productive summer. We're now coming into a time period where I would say, in a way, playing defense. I mean, I think we are just trying to just make sure bad things aren't snuck in there. We're just trying to be wary of what's going to be done and making sure we respond appropriately to it.
Well, were there any committee hearings of importance this past week or any coming up?
Okay. We continually, and we may even talk about it later on in the show, but I, being on the Environmental Committee, being the Democratic chair, our Republican chair is very active. We had recently had a hearing basically on pipelines. We've had a number of hearings relating to Chairman Medcalf's effort to block the VOC regs. We had actually a very interesting hearing, background information on the hydrogen hub and hydrogen as a fuel source, which was a public hearing. And although I don't particularly like the ideology of our chairman, I do like the fact that it's an active committee. And we do meet a lot, and I do learn a lot. So as far as your question about committee hearings, we have done that this summer, and we'll probably continue to do that until the term's over.
Well, what is a hydrogen hub for those that aren't that familiar, and what makes this issue so important here in Pennsylvania?
Right. Good questions. Hydrogen and a hydrogen hub generally is a series of parts and infrastructure designed to produce hydrogen. Now, hydrogen is viewed by climate change experts as a necessary piece to decarbonizing and getting us to carbon neutrality by mid-century. Part and parcel of this hydrogen hub. Well, okay, let's producing hydrogen, which is a fuel source, a clean burning fuel source. One of hydrogen's values is that when it burns, it does not release CO2. So you have a fuel source which is carbon free. The key point here is how do you make hydrogen? And if you can make it in a way that is environmentally benign, like using renewable energy, like wind and solar to make hydrogen, and that's called green hydrogen. Or you can do it in a very destructive way from a climate change perspective and make it by the burning of fossil fuels like coal and gas. And if you don't capture the carbon from making it that way, and you have this dirty hydrogen called gray hydrogen. Now, in the middle of those two, if you make hydrogen using, let's say, natural gas, but you capture it and store it underground, then you have blue hydrogen, which is good. And there's green hydrogen, and then there's pink hydrogen with nuclear, and there's turquoise hydrogen. It gets kind of crazy. But I think with regard to this hydrogen hub we're talking about, it's a series of parts designed to make hydrogen in theory for uses that you can't get away from fossil fuels from using. For example, there are certain sectors of our economy that are very difficult to decarbonize. You can very easily, relatively speaking, decarbonize the making of electricity generally, but you just substitute wind and solar and hydro. You can do that. You can't decarbonize like the steel making or cement making, because that requires the burning of natural gas or hydrogen, and which requires that intense heat. So with regard to certain sectors of the economy, which you can't easily decarbonize, hydrogen is a solution. But the key is you have to be able to use carbon capture, and that is not commercially feasible right now. So that was we had a recent public hearing in the Environmental Committee on that. And I think that's one of the things we were discussing.
Well, yeah, let's go ahead and take a look at a clip from that hearing right now.
I'm still trying to get my head around this. And I do know, just based on my readings, that hydrogen is considered something that environmentalists and people conscious of climate change understand may be necessary for certain industrial applications like cement plants and steel production and so forth. But the idea of using hydrogen with regard to power generation generally, you know, for the electricity that's lighting up this room, for example, it's my understanding that when you factor in the cost of carbon capture, it's simply not environmentally feasible, or it's the better way to approach it would be to expand renewables. So do you agree with that assessment that with regard to general electricity production, the better approach is not to pursue hydrogen as a power source, but renewable energy expansion?
So what makes Pennsylvania such a suitable location for this kind of energy production?
Right. So it has most or almost all the elements needed for a hydrogen hub. It because of the existing gas industry, it has pipelines in place to transport this captured CO2 from the emitter of the CO2 to where it must be stored. So there's pipelines here. There also is the pore space to hold the carbon, because when you extract oil or CO2 from the ground, you're leaving a vacuum there. And these vacuums are caverns or spaces or places in the ground to put that. So you have that. You also need potential users of hydrogen. And you have steel producers. In fact, there's one steel producer in Pennsylvania who's already in contact with the administration with regard to get a tax break for using hydrogen to make steel. So you have the users, the pore space, the infrastructure, and you have the workforce. You have skilled workers from, you know, the oil and gas and coal industry. You have those basic skills. So you have a lot of the elements. And so and because it is suitable, Pennsylvania and Governor Wolf are very interested in pursuing federal money that is out there for hydrogen hubs. The federal government under President Biden has offered large sums of money, and they're looking to see, I don't know whether it was a half a dozen hydrogen hubs established throughout the country. And this hydrogen hub, which would include not only Pennsylvania, but Ohio and West Virginia, I think is a lead candidate to be one of those recipients of money. But I think the key point I want to convey to people is, you know, this can be done the right way or this can be done the wrong way. And if it's done the right way, that means that all of the or almost all of the hydrogen, all of the natural gas used to produce this hydrogen is captured. So it is a tool to get us to carbon neutrality. The problem and my big fear and why I need and people who care about the environment need to be vigilant is it could easily be done the wrong way. In other words, if you produce hydrogen using natural gas, but you emit all sorts of CO2 because you're not capturing it, then you're just perpetuating the fossil fuel industry at the expense of achieving climate change goals. I mean, I'm a bit of a cynic, but I'm worried about the old bait and switch where we get deep into this hydrogen hub and then we fail to meet our goal of capturing the CO2. So all we're really doing is continuing to contribute to climate change. And that's why how we do it, the legislation we write and the act we take are just so important to this process.
Well, with that said, are there any bills that are going to need to be passed in the future to kind of get this production off the ground?
Yeah, and they're working on them now. And the question is this something we can get done between now and the end of the term? One of the bills they're working on is a carbon capture bill. I've seen some preliminary language. Senator Yaw, who's the Republican chair of the Senate Environmental Committee, is going back and forth with the administration on this that would sort of set out the ground rules for carbon capture. I actually just coincidentally had a bill, House Bill 80, maybe 10 years ago that also had carbon capture provisions, but it wasn't thought of that well at the time. But so the Yaw bill is one of the pieces to this, the carbon capture piece. Also, there's talk of a tax credit for companies who use hydrogen or somehow also facilitate this hydrogen hub, and $600 million is the figure we're hearing about that. So it's probably another piece of legislation relating to tax breaks that needs to be crafted. And that would probably be a broader economic development bill as opposed to just a bill just for the hydrogen hub only. So that's out there. So there's at least two bills out there. Whether it can get done between now and the end of the term, not sure, but we're keeping our eye on it.
Well, we've also been following VOC regulations closely on this program. For those who aren't familiar, what are they and where are we at on those?
Right. So that's another, you know, just as the hydrogen hub is a measure to address climate change potentially, reducing VOCs or volatile organic compounds from oil and gas drilling, in theory, is another piece. Because VOCs and methane go hand in hand, and methane is a very powerful greenhouse gas. So when you reduce VOCs, you usually are reducing this greenhouse gas too. It's going at a snail's pace. The governor back in 2016 proposed his methane reduction strategy, and we still haven't gotten it done. The particular piece we're working on right now deals with conventional and unconventional wells. Regulations have been sort of moving through the Environmental Quality Board. The regulations relating to unconventional as opposed to conventional drilling, they were kind of separated, and the regulations for the unconventional move separately were approved by the Environmental Quality Board, are ready for publication, but are being blocked by in this case, the chairman of the Environmental Committee, our beloved Daryl Metcalf, who's a climate denier. And we recently, frankly, had a hearing which involved debate over one of his measures to block these very important regulations.
Well, you spoke about VOC regulations, methane, and the effects on climate change at that hearing. Let's take a look at that now.
I wanted to pick up on a comment you made about methane emissions. Climate change is the most serious long-term threat to this planet, and we don't need to be reminded of that because we have Hurricane Fiona, which has just knocked out almost the entire power system of Puerto Rico, as Hurricane Maria did several years ago. And methane and these storms, these deadly storms, are made more intense by climate change. That's what science tells us. Methane is a powerful greenhouse gas, the second most powerful greenhouse gas after CO2, and a contributor to climate change. Now, we have regulations relating to the control of this methane from pipelines, from unconventional pipelines of the natural gas industry. The existing pipelines, wellheads, and so forth. My question to you is, does the Marcellus Shale Coalition support the current VOC regulations relating to the control of methane from the unconventional gas industry which are currently being blocked by efforts by this committee in jeopardizing over $500 million in highway funds. Does the Marcellus Shale Coalition support these VOC regulations?
Does Representative Metcalf have support for this resolution from Republican leadership?
You know what, so that resolution did pass his committee, but I think his leadership is smart enough to realize that it's really, they're not going to support that resolution on the House floor because the unconventional regs are not opposed by the unconventional industry, the people who are going to be subjects of them, they're not complaining. And two, they get, I mean, that loss of highway funds would be a really bad thing. It means projects in most people's districts. Delaware County loses, for example, $18 million. I think next year, I think Montgomery County loses 54, 58 million, somewhere in the $50 million area. So I don't think Republican leadership is going to cooperate at all on that. I'm highly confident of that. So what probably will happen is something will happen. I was talking to the Wolf administration higher ups earlier this week, and so they're going to do something, but not quite sure what. Possibly passing some emergency regulations, possibly a bill which would essentially do the same thing as these regulations. But we're hoping for a fix prior to the end of the term, so we don't lose that highway funding.
Well, how can we start to kind of make this shift to renewables? How do we start?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So I think we talked beforehand about the need to expand solar, and there's a bill that we've talked about previous shows, the community solar issue. Community solar creates a framework where private solar developers, without the approval of electric distribution companies like PECO, they can, on their own, develop these smaller solar fields and contract with customers like me and you, who really don't have roofs suitable for our own solar, and basically sell us solar. Now they need legislation because they are the flow of electrons from this solar field, the community solar field, would go through, let's say, the PECO grid, and the billing for this would come through the PECO bill, and PECO's, for example, some utilities, I mean, Duquesne Power is one of them, but there's a lot of balking from the utility industry. But you need to create a framework for this to happen now. And we've been trying to do that for a long time. Now, there is a bill, not to be confused with community solar, it's called local solar by Republican House member Ms. Gorski, who's running for re-election to be a senator right now, which environmentalists, is called local solar, which environmentalist term is a big nothing burger because it kind of already grants utilities the authority they already have, and it doesn't let private development, you know, be in control of things. That is moving through the Senate right now, the Mazursky bill, and we're trying to amend the language of community solar into that. I mean, there was a Senate hearing actually earlier this past week, and there's just some back and forth right now. So our hope is that we can basically force the community solar issue by tacking it on to the local solar issue, if that's not confusing enough. and get that signed into law. So that's one of the, I mean, that could be a really, you know, pleasant little surprise for us, you know, before the end of the term, if we could get community solar done.
Well, we've only got about 3 minutes left or so, so I do want to touch on the upcoming election. What should people know? When's the last day to register?
Right. So one thing they should know is that it's on November 8th. They should know that what's on the ballot is just incredibly important for both Pennsylvania and our country. I mean, at the gubernatorial level, the two candidates, Mastriano and Shapiro, I'm not going to get overly political, but the choices are just so stark there, and that you have Fetterman and Oz at the U.S. Senate level, and again, not to be political, but two very different ideologies, and control of the Senate could be in the balance. And then you have lower level races, U.S. Congress. You know, you have, I don't think we have a state Senate race. You have my state House race and other state House races. So it's very, you know, it's a really important for at least the upper two races. Election days, November 8th, October 24th is the last day to register to vote, which is 2 weeks out. I think the last day to return absentee ballots is November 1st. At some point, you just can't trust the mail anymore for those things. So if you're going to do that, you ought to do it early. There are drop boxes, which are an easy way to kind of return them. In our area, there's going to be one in front of the Haverford Township Administration Building, which is actually right across from my office. There's going to be one in Marple at the that complex, the library complex where the municipal building is, and other locations. It's really important. Register if you're not. Make sure you get your absentee ballots in early if you're going to vote that way. If not, just get out to the polls. Get out to the polls and vote.
We've only got about 90 seconds left. So what's the status of your district office at the moment?
Okay, so we're at Darby and Manel Roads. We are sort of in our non-COVID mode, meaning you don't need to make an appointment, and we will do all those things. Satellite office is not operating right now because we're down to one staffer. We just hired two more, and once they come in early October, we'll do the satellite office again. And we have a wonderful staffer. We're doing well. Just probably best to call for an appointment anyway, but just give us a call. We can handle all your state related needs, handicap placards and set the senior IDs and helping you fill out your property tax rent rebate. And yep, any, you know, we'll do what we can to help you.
Well, State Representative Greg Vitali, thank you so much for taking the time to join us today.
Thank you.